Welcome to Love in the Love Boat, where we break down episodes of one of the greatest romantic comedy drama television series of all time. I'm Istvan, Chicagoland's beloved children's musician and TV fanatic.
And I'm Michelle, pop culture enthusiast.
So come aboard. We're expecting you to join us for another edition of
Love in the Love Boat.
Here we are, back for another fun-filled episode, episode 8. And we would like to welcome back, we would like to say aloha to our previous guest and friend, Steven Dorian Slivka.
Yay!
Woo! Welcome back.
Yeah, welcome back.
Thank you for having me, especially on this episode. I really can't thank you enough for that.
He did send me a text that said, thanks a lot for making me watch one with Sandy Duncan.
This episode is upsetting. I was making notes and I didn't even know what to write down because it was such an upsetting episode. There's nothing fun about this episode at all.
See, I disagree. Hang on.
This you guys. The Sandy Duncan story, like, I cried twice. I just want to tell you. And this is my second time seeing it. I've cried twice.
This is if Lars von Trier made an episode of The Love Boat, it would be this episode.
Well, speaking of, because we never talk about this, the director, I looked it up this time.
Uh-huh.
And his name is Stuart Margolin.
Uh-huh.
And he was both an actor and a director. And he actually won Emmys, not for this episode. But
yeah, horrible drama did he win Emmys for?
All right, hang on, you guys.
Oh, yeah. And he won a supporting actor Emmy for The Rockford Files.
These guys, they're off the rails. And I knew that this was going to be a tough one to navigate and to wrangle. Now, hang on. Allow me, before we get into the specifics that traumatized you, obviously...
Yeah.
To give the three storylines first and our guest stars on this episode. All right. So the first storyline we have is The Understudy, written by Ben Jolson and Art Bear. Maybe two names that are familiar. We also have Married Singles, written by Ray Jessel. And we have Lost and Found, written by Bruce Shelley.
Sure now, was.
Would you guys like to help me announce our guest stars?
I'll let you do Lost and Found. Let's get some... It traumatized.
So Lost and Found was our guest stars on Lost and Found is the great Sandy Duncan.
Yes.
Triple threat. She's amazing normally. She acts up a storm in this one. Followed and supported by Jim Stafford, who everybody knows is known for Swamp Witch, which was a top 10 song in 1974. Actually, it wasn't top 10, it was top 100.
Jim Stafford is from this line, and tell me if you guys can add to this. When we were growing up, there was this like crop of crossover country kind of nice guys, right?
Yeah.
Jim Stafford would be to me the C level of these people. You had like... who sang Rhinestone Cow? Glenn Campbell, right?
Sure.
So he'd be on TV and you'd see him. Mac Davis is at the top, man. He's at the top tier. I feel Jim Stafford was in...
He was in the mix.
...depth on this episode for what he was required to do.
Yeah.
But there were all these likable guys. Can you think of anybody else?
What was Jim Stafford's big hit?
Spiders and Snakes.
Spiders and Snakes,
I have no idea that any of his music... Spiders and Snakes.
You don't know that song?
Did you write that song?
Do you know the song?
Did I? No.
Listen.
Spiders... We're going to get hit by the Stafford... You know this song? I have never heard this song.
Wait for the chorus. Here comes.
I don't remember this song.
Really?
No.
It's like, it's so good. And it's like, remember like in the early 70s, like country was kind of crossing over with
everywhere, yeah.
And he even wrote songs for Jerry Reed.
Jerry Reed, he's the other dude I love, but he would not have been good in this role. Jerry Reed's my favorite, but like...
No one would have been good in this role. This role is horrible.
He was good though. His close-ups.
No, so I wrote down, you talk about his close-ups, here's the note I wrote down. Jim Stafford turns into a werewolf. Like, he's like frozen.
We haven't even given the backstory.
Wait, you know what, too, though? Yeah. They all had beautiful eyes. Like I don't make a joke about Sandy Duncan's eye, but like, she has beautiful eyes. She has beautiful blue eyes.
She does.
And then Meryl Stubing does, Julie does, Jim Stafford does, and Steve Allen's wife all had beautiful blue eyes. Like, I noticed it watching this the second time around. All right, wait, hang on. Who else do we have on the show? So we have those two guys.
Yep.
Who else is starring on this episode?
So Married Singles, the guest stars were Polly Bergen, no relation to the great Edgar Bergen, near as I can tell. And, of course, Steve Allen.
His name was Durwood. His name was Durwood on this.
Durwood Moss.
Durwood. Did you ever meet a Durwood in your life?
No.
So far across the board, maybe in every episode, one of the male protagonists is named something that is absolutely outlandish that you've never experienced in real life.
Yeah, and Maisie Nolan, played by Polly Bergen, of course. So that's Married Singles. And who was the guest star of The Understudy, Michelle?
Her name was Joanne Harris.
What is she known for?
Well, I like Joanne Harris. I'm going to tie back to the director that I had brought up earlier. He had one of the Emmys he had won was for the Tracy Ullman show. He had directed an episode. And when I was doing my cross research, she was in one of the episodes. So maybe they remained friends or they dated.
She's cute, man. She's super cute.
But she played a great... Well, we haven't even, like I said, gone into like the storylines of each thing.
Shortly thereafter, as we get into the cruise, because this couple arrives onto the ship pretending that they do not know one another. Why?
Because they're trying to, I don't know, spice up their marriage.
She's unhappy because she feels like the spark is gone and that he doesn't say I love you enough to her. And so I don't know what their plan was on the ship to go on and...
Oh, I think their plan was to have separate vacations.
Oh, okay.
But he booked the cabin next to her.
Okay.
For whatever
reason. And he doesn't, like, as you know, as a man, you know, the privilege of just doing whatever you want back in this time, for sure. He doesn't think that there's anything wrong with their relationship, but she's saying that there is, you know. He doesn't
see. It's like a trial separation.
They're the comic relief.
Excuse me. Miss Nolan. Okay, Maisie, where did you put my shorts?
See, yelling about your shorts in the middle of a hall. If anybody finds out we're married, you're going to blow the whole idea.
Well, separate vacations wasn't my idea.
Oh, some separate vacations? You took the cabin right next door. Believe me, this is not what the marriage counselor had in mind.
Ah, that guy was a waste of money. Look, Maisie, you know I love you.
Oh, well, you sure never tell me anymore.
I just told you. Remember me talking? I was glasses standing right here.
Very funny, very funny.
All right, and then we have the very, very serious couple, Jim Stafford, Sandy Duncan, coming on, dealing with something so unexpected and so heavy.
Oh, God.
The death of their 8-year-old son.
Yeah.
So go on a cruise.
Yeah.
Where there's going to be children and everything else. I guess maybe it's just trying to get
the thing over. That was so similar to Sandy Duncan and Steven P. Slivka is he can't stand the sound of children laughing either.
I wrote down, Sandy Duncan is upset and Jim Stafford wants to party. That was the note, is that he's trying so hard to enjoy the trip throughout this, and she is not enjoying it.
Well, see, that's the thing about this.
Because she's a mom.
No, hang on, let's get heavy. Yeah, well, she's inconsolable. She cannot get past this, and understandably so.
They should not have gone on this trip.
Even though I'm saying that Jim Stafford was in over his head as far as, like, not having the acting chops to pull this off, you know, this sort of thing, as a character, he was really... good guy because he was trying so hard to be supportive. He was trying to endure all of this and he's trying to move on with life and she just can't. And I did get emotional during one of the parts because
it's horrible. It's so sad.
Oh, I got so upset. But it really, this is where I'm saying like the Love Boat. I'm like, I wasn't prepared for this watching the Love Boat. I thought everything
Every
was going to be
funny. Every time she cried, I cried and like my eyes got watery.
She was very convincing. But here's my question. And I wonder if you guys know the answer to this question. When a guest star got booked on the Love Boat, did they see the script before or after they got booked on the Love Boat? Because I gotta think that there was a time when both Sandy Duncan and her manager and Jim Stafford and his manager are screaming at each other, going, "Why did you book?" Like, Jim Stafford is supposedly a comedian. And then he got booked on this, and
That's true.
Is the storyline. It
a heavy,
is a disaster.
Heavy storyline.
Oh, could be.
Yeah.
Could be. Because he really did seem like he was blindsided. Yeah, that could be true. That's a good call.
He looked like just shell-shocked through the whole thing.
It's kind of true. It is kind of true. Maybe you might be right. You might be right about that. But the part that really emotionally got me was when they came back into the cabin after she heard children's laughter, and she couldn't handle it. He was trying to get her to come back out. She couldn't do it. And then he turned around and said...
those things, babe. We can't stop living. That's a terrible thing to do to Terry's memory. We can't destroy the only thing we have left of him.
Oh, Richard. How does it make sense to get hurt so much from loving so much? Oh, Richard.
I don't know, baby. I don't know. I guess nobody does.
unpack. Half of the stuff is still in the bags.
Yeah, I'll help.
No! I want you to get out of here and give me some room.
Okay, I'll have a drink.
Okay.
I love you, Sharon.
Don't stop. Oh, God, please don't stop. Rich.
He said, you know, I love you. And then she stops for a moment. She says, don't stop, you know, like, and then they embrace.
Oh, I remember. Yeah.
But it's like the fact that like, this is enough to destroy your entire relationship. And they're showing these two people supporting one another, still finding that knit, maybe bringing them closer together. And then at least there was the normal element of just a kid coming into the room.
Are we
jumping right to this?
Yeah, because
just going to jump right
into the storyline is a little kid.
We got to go back.
Are we just jumping in this?
No, go ahead. A little kid. Why? Say it.
Books his own cruise.
It's so outlandish and
he's
absurd.
He's like, what, 10?
Yeah.
11?
James Bond III.
Yeah, that's the actor. And his name was Theodore?
Theodore Dennison.
Let's meet Theodore Dennison, maybe a precursor to Gary Coleman.
That's what I was thinking.
It seemed like that was the period of time. Hang on, let's officially meet this precocious, very independent young man.
Please, I'm busy. I'm short one passenger.
Theodore Dennison, Jr.
I'm Theodore Dennison, Jr.
Well, Mr. D, welcome aboard. Listen, you better tell your folks to hurry up or they're not going to make it.
Nah, see?
Please.
The folks are like trying to make it. They're back in Stockton. But it's okay. Hey, look, I've got permission.
What's it say?
Theodore paid for his cruise out of his newspaper money, and he is old enough to travel alone. Signed, Mom.
The whole thing about this kid is insane. I mean, it's just absolutely insane because he shows up. One of the things that also drove me nuts is he was doing the thing that happened back in the time where he had a cool radio that I kind of envied still to this day.
Oh, yeah. I wrote and down, how do I get this radio?
Yeah, it's the best. Oh, my God. But then he's playing that weird generic music that they would always play back then. It has like
generic funk.
Yeah, like generic, like, yeah, funk, exactly, like rock,
it's like
funk, rock.
It's like country funk.
It's the weirdest, like, anyone ever listened to that
and
music
like a
ever.
Big guitar slide, like,
yeah. He's grooving to this music, but he shows up, and then they had to stretch so hard to make it, like, where they can't leave the kid, and he gets to come on a cruise.
I mean, essentially, he's a runaway, but somehow he booked a cruise, and then, which I didn't understand, it's like, the ship really hadn't taken off yet.
You can't make a phone call till you leave the
no.
port.
It didn't make
supposedly.
Sense. They were still throwing the confetti and the
this
stuff.
Was,
and the
this
kids,
was...
they could have got the kid off the boat.
I give them a wide berth for trying to like establish these premises, but that one was just so
was
absolutely
stretch.
Out of control.
And then he had the room next to Sandy Duncan and her husband.
By coincidence.
Yeah.
Bruce Shelley.
Yeah, but see, it's like a little bit afterwards, I was already confused as to like what this kid was doing and why. You know what I mean? You needed to understand why he is left. You know, he's a runaway, right? What was the reason for this? And then the captain and Gopher, a little bit later, bump into him as he's just wandering the ship by himself.
By himself.
And they're totally
without
okay
a chaperone.
With it. Right.
Yeah.
They're all okay with it. Just
he
like,
actually
fine.
Gets on the elevator and goes like, see you later. Like, and they just accept that as being okay.
Yeah. Yeah. But when they meet him, then he finally like explains what the issue and problem was.
Mr. Dennison.
Hey.
Just the man I'm looking for.
Mr. D, you are in a lot of trouble. You remember the captain?
Yeah, what's happening?
Yes, well, we finally reached your parents, and, well, they've been chasing around all night trying to find you. Theodore, you got them worried sick.
I mean, they're not worried about me. They're worried about themselves. They fight. They talking about getting a divorce. Hey, look, I figure if they're splitting, I'm splitting.
Mr. Dennison, you're a pretty gutsy guy.
But we think you should know that your parents plan on meeting the ship in Puerto Vallarta, and they want to take you back home with them.
Hey, look, I got no home. When do we get to this Porter place?
Day after tomorrow.
Well, maybe by then I have a home. I'll see y'all guys later, man. Be cool.
this kid just, he endured, like, just like his parents were arguing, so he decides that he's going to run away from home.
That's correct. To Mazatlan.
And felt that he was going to be able to find a whole new family to just adopt him? Because that seemed like that was his MO.
Makes total sense.
Sandy Duncan seemed to think it was plausible.
Yeah, so this is where, so I don't know where we are in the timeline here, but at some point, Sandy Duncan full-on loses her mind and is in total psychosis.
You look beautiful.
Well, you're looking pretty good yourself. You know, Theodore thinks you are very together.
Listen, hon, about Theodore.
Isn't he something? Can you imagine a kid with his background, one orphanage after another, still turned out great? Hey, Richard, with the advantages we could give him.
Sharon, he has parents.
Oh, he does not.
I spoke to the captain today. He ran away from home. His parents are coming to pick him up in Puerto Vallarta.
I see. And who paid for his cabin on this ship?
He did. With his newspaper route money.
That's ridiculous. He just told everybody that story because he doesn't want them to know the truth. Richard, nobody wants him. He told me. His uncle in Mexico paid for the trip. Theodore is being forced on him because he happens to be a relative. He's going to be taken off this ship to live the rest of his childhood with a man who doesn't give a damn about him.
Sweetheart, even if that were true, which I doubt, we couldn't do anything about it.
Can we just see what happens in Puerto Vallarta, please?
Okay.
Thank you.
Because she just takes up this kid as her own kid.
Yeah, he has a nightmare and he just comes into a stranger's room and then she's like, "Get in bed with me and let me comfort you."
That's totally normal.
We need to walk through that whole moment, okay? No, we're going to relive this right now together. People at home, please sit down, get a drink. This is important. This was so insane and so disturbing and so wrong and nothing you could even come close to doing today. The kid's next door, knock on the door. He's in his pajamas. Jim Stafford, did you hear what he said too when what was his name? Thelonious? What's his name? What's the kid's name? What's the kid's name?
Theodore.
Theodore.
Theodore Denison. Right.
Theodore knocks on the door saying that he's having some sort of like nightmare or something like that. And he's like, "Can I come in?" He doesn't know these people at all, right?
No.
And then Jim Stafford goes, "Come in."
No.
It's real dark and disturbing.
That's Jim Stafford acting.
But you don't even see him. So you just see the kid out in the hall. And he's like, "Come in."
Why wouldn't you call like the captain and be like,
"Nothing about this is okay."
But like he hops in bed with Sandy Duncan. She's like brushing his hair aside or whatever she's doing.
She's being a mom, but it's a little But this much. Is
very murdery.
This is the only way that you can rationalize it though, is like she was so disturbed and distraught and hurt by the loss of the child that now this is the one thing that is bringing her out of that abyss of depression.
Here's what I don't understand. This is the Love Boat. What?
She's got a love for this kid.
What possessed Bruce Shelley to sit down and go, "I know what I'm going to do.
Alcohol.
I'm going to cook up a good story where a kid dies.
Alcohol
and
abuse.
And then the other kid is going to replace the kid." Why?
They were tackling some heavy subject matter.
This is horrible.
That's what I appreciate about the show. And I didn't expect this.
No,
First were going to jump back on board with the show, we were not. I wasn't prepared for it at all.
Oh.
But after the kid was in the bed for a while, it did seem cool, right?
Let's go to the understudy. We haven't talked about Connie Evans yet, really.
Miss McCoy?
Connie Evans?
Yes.
Welcome aboard.
Thank you.
Ah, well, Yeoman Purser Smith at your service. Isaac Washington, Chief Barman.
I'm Dr. Adam Bricker, the ship's physician. If you have any questions about your body...
Doc! It's really nice to meet you all. Connie, don't let these clowns scare you. The rest of the crew is normal.
Oh, Connie, believe me, we're the only ones worth knowing. Rest of the crew is strictly chopped liver.
And on behalf of all of us chopped liver, allow me to introduce myself. I'm Captain Steuben.
I'm just leaving.
Nice to meet you. My offer still holds.
Okay. It's an honor to meet you, sir. I've heard so much about you.
Here's my first note for the understudy. I hate this. That's my first note. This show is a horror movie, is my second note, as it relates to the
Wow, this one really impacted you in a dark way. I didn't find it that way. I thought it was fun.
No, I didn't think it was fun at all. From the word go, she's undermining Julie.
Oh, yeah, she establishes that right from the get-go. Because she's like, "I'd give anything to have your job, Julie."
Yeah,
yeah.
So anyway, this understudy is, they're training her, and she wants Julie's job.
And Captain Steuving falls for it from the word go.
She's a pretty pretty girl, I guess.
No, but he's busy. He's got a lot of stuff on his mind, and he can't be micromanaging everything. So, like, she took that as an opportunity to lie, you know, and mislead, you know. She's smart. It's how you're successful in life sometimes. You know, that's how you get to be the cruise director, Slivka.
No. You know how you get to be cruise director? Hard work. That's how you get to be cruise director.
But see, that's why Julie's so great, because she even is like sort of like accepting of this. She's there to help her immediately. She's such a nice person that she's like somewhat allowing this to happen in a way. And then throughout this, she's just, I mean, we could all hope to be as great as Julie McCoy was. Well,
there is a part where she wishes death on Connie Evans, which was pretty great.
Yeah, that was pretty funny.
But for the most part, she was virtuous and sort of fair throughout.
Yeah, even when she was lying, stealing Julie's ideas for the country western night.
Hey, with the country western night, that didn't make any sense to me. You know why?
Why?
She had the idea, right? Julie's got the idea.
During the cruise.
What do you think of my idea for the captain's cocktail party? Wild West night. We'll get all the crew and all the passengers and everybody dress up in western clothes, and we'll have the waiters wear big old handlebar mustaches and big cowboy hats, and oh, and we'll serve mugs of beer and red eye, and we'll just all sit around and sing all those old western songs. What do you think?
I think that's terrific. Good evening, all.
Good evening, sir.
Miss Evans has just told me about a wonderful idea she has for my farewell cocktail party, a Wild West night.
No kidding.
But here, check it out. If you're having this Western night, Julie comes up with the idea, then Connie steals the idea from her, right?
Right.
Where did everybody get country clothing
from?
So that is exactly what I wrote down.
Where did they get
Steve Allen had weird country outfit on. His wife did.
Everybody did.
Somehow had country.
Where did the bales of hay come from?
Yes, I had that. Why did they have bales of hay? If she didn't.
I didn't even notice the bales of hay.
Came up with it during the cruise.
It was like a brainstorming thing, and then all of a sudden they have everyone's got something to wear. And why, when they're all hanging out, the whole crew, did they give Isaac the comedy mustache? He already has a mustache.
I thought
Bernie Coppell would have been funnier with the mustache, don't you think?
I don't know. That didn't make any sense. Maybe he didn't want to wear the mustache because he's got an image to keep.
That's what I thought. That's exactly what I thought, because he was sitting there like really, really cool.
Doctor. Yeah. I can't wear the funny mustache.
But you think Fred Grandy at least would have. He seemed like he'd be up for something like that, and they put the big giant
mustache. You know what? Ted's a professional, and he was there to play the role and do it, and he said, give me the mustache. I'll wear it, you
the
guys.
Big white mustache.
He was the good guy in all this because he called.
You know what else? There was a second pie or cake gag.
Yeah, too. He fell on the cake.
Gopher fell flat on the cake. That's the second time.
How about Gopher's Captain Steubing impersonation?
It was very good, didn't you think?
Someone call it uncanny.
Hello?
Did you get my roses?
Oh, it's you. Hello. Yes. Yes, they are beautiful.
She buys it. Please, call me Merle.
Call me a cab.
That was amazing.
So dumb.
Yet he wouldn't do a John Wayne, the impression everybody can do. You know, it's like, but he did a perfect
A dead-on Captain Steubing.
And then, you know, on the inappropriate parade here, then Merrill all of a sudden is super nice to Connie, creepy throughout the whole thing. And just completely blind eye to Connie's
It is a sex ship. You know this, right? It is kind of like, I think it is a sex ship.
I'm going on a cruise. I want to relax. I want to read. Next,
I
want to get a zombie,
ladies and gentlemen,
and not be called one.
Look good
by the what is Isaac? He's like he's not just a bartender; he's like the chief bartender.
I think that's what he's.
You know, I can attest to this being very true because I received text from Steven P Slivka while he's in Hawaii, and I'm like, "What are you doing?" It's like he really does just want to relax.
Yeah, I just want to relax with my zombie by the too tiny pool.
Yeah,
that doesn't have a lot of water in it. And I want to enjoy myself.
Oh, I hate that pool.
It's kind of gross water looking, too.
It is definitely gross.
It's like a mold pond.
It's the 70s.
Wait. Loni Anderson is on this ship.
Yeah.
Correct.
And they don't even credit her in the beginning. You see her kind of for a moment. And it's weird because, like, that's the other thing. Was she known at this point? WKRP in Cincinnati
was not a show yet.
No, I think this was her, like,
this
starting.
Was early.
Because you know why? Like, when she comes, this is so confusing to me, this part. Because Loni Anderson comes into the dining room and the Steve Allen and Polly Bergen, like, they're kind of, like, sparring with one another. She's sitting with some guy, which, again, back in this time, being a handsome man was not a difficult thing to be, it seemed. Because they're like, oh, look at this guy.
Catch out his teeth.
Oh my gosh, she was
Oh, are you talking about Jack?
Yeah.
Jack Plymouth?
Insurance salesman.
Jack Plymouth. Yeah. At least that's a plausible name, though.
I wrote down Jack Plymouth and Connie Bergen have the same haircut. That was the note I wrote down.
He just has less of it than her.
Yeah, but
he
same.
It's a good call. Right. They would have made a good couple.
Really a good call. Yeah.
So like she comes into the dining room, she's staring at a card, I guess, with her assigned table, and she's looking at it really closely, like maybe she's...
She's playing the dumb blonde.
Her name's Barbie, and hang on, you guys, she does such an exceptional job.
She does do a good job.
Of playing the ditzy blonde character, and her voicing is next level.
Is this table number 9?
Well, yeah, it can be any number you want.
Oh, then I'd like it to be 9.
Good.
This is my very first cruise on the sea. Hi.
Hi.
I'm Barbie.
I'm Ken. I mean,
Okay, so after that, after they introduce Loni Anderson formally on the ship, she is kind of paired up with Steve Allen completely wrongly, as if Loni Anderson would be with Steve Allen.
And that she did make a joke about him being like her father.
Her father. But then towards the end, it seems like she really is interested, like wanting to go to his room and stuff like that, which I could not comprehend.
None of it made any sense.
Yeah, like I can't wait to get with this older guy.
And Steve Allen to boot.
Yeah, that just didn't make any sense. But he wasn't being gross. He was
actually...
I think
that was testing the bounds of her ability to be...
No, his character wasn't being really creepy because he was still in love with his wife.
Yeah, no, he was really great and he was very sweet and he was. He was constantly like paying attention finally. You know, it was finally getting through to him. See, I enjoyed this episode. I liked it. I thought it was absolutely shocking, but I did enjoy the episode. I thought it was fun.
Here's a high point of all the emotional devastation that was wrought upon the viewer in this episode. The one good part that I liked was when they were dancing at dinner, when Steve Allen and Polly Bergen were dancing at dinner. It was following that old like trope that was used on The Muppet Show, like during the dance scenes.
Oh, yeah.
Where they're winging out one-liners between dancing. It was really funny, and there was a bunch of super old jokes, but it was actually pretty good. Other than that, I would have chucked this whole episode.
You're nuts, dude.
I don't know. I thought it was just like a heavy episode. It was like super heavy.
Hang on. I'm going to prove him wrong right now. I'm going to drop a clip right on his head, okay? Because when Polly Bergen is hanging out with Fro Guy in the room.
Jack Plymouth.
Yeah. She really got the raw end of the deal there.
Jack Plymouth?
Yeah.
He's just trying to sell some insurance already.
But she's a good-looking older woman.
She was.
Better-looking than Steve Allen.
Yeah, definitely.
But as they are goofing around and she's trying to make it seem as if something is happening between her and Jack Plymouth to make him jealous, make Steve Allen jealous, she comes out into the hallway.
Eavesdropper. Well, I'm glad you heard what went on. It's obvious that Jack's crazy about me. I had to fight to keep him out of my cabin.
Are you kidding? He was trying to sell you insurance in the middle of the night. Let's face it, nothing's happening there and nothing is going to.
Oh, really? Well, you just tune in tomorrow night and you'll hear something that'll make your ears drop off.
The way he delivered it was
funny.
So good.
That was funny.
And I thought he had some really solid lines, and I thought he did a really, really good job. I didn't think that it was... Because stuff can get certainly super cornball, for sure. But I thought that he did a really good job, and those two together were pretty good together, you know?
Michelle, you might have mentioned this, but Steve Allen's shirts were the greatest thing I've ever seen in my life.
When he stepped foot on the by the pool, oh my God. It was crazy.
They were the greatest.
He had really good shirts.
I need to start, because the last time you were here was so fun, and we were talking about the Terry Cloth one. And we really do need to try and locate these, see if we can find any of this stuff somewhere, and then wear them. you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah, I know what you mean.
We need to rock these clothes. We need to start hunting this stuff down.
They were amazing.
I say it, like, the women's dresses were amazing.
You see Sandy Duncan? She had the little, like, anchor on her dress.
Yes,
so cute.
I noticed that. Her dress was so cute with that little rhinestone anchor.
Oh, yeah, she looked adorable. She looked so great on here.
Sandy Duncan was awesome on this.
So this is full thank you to my wife. Nolan Bertrandoff Miller was the designer on The Love Boat. So we can thank Nolan Bertrandoff Miller for these costumes.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
amazing.
Very good.
So
we need to get a little more backstory
on
that, too.
Also, yes, Angela, my wife, found this.
And, thanks,
Ange. And thank you.
So Nolan Miller, just a little aside here, because this is legendary from a costumery standpoint, did Dynasty. So
I can't believe you have to look on a phone for this information and that you just don't have it.
It's not even on. I'm pretending that I'm looking it up, but I really know it by heart.
Getting back to the one with Julie and her whatever trainee trying to take her job, Isaac is the good guy always, and he tried to warn everybody that she was lying and trying to steal Julie's job. And in the beginning, they weren't having it, but
yeah, because explained it to everybody. Doc and Gopher are both trying to get with this woman. You know, they're too busy, you know, pursuing her in that way. And Isaac is not swayed by that. I believe it's because Isaac is very intuitive. He deals with people all the time.
He's a bartender. They know everything.
Look, he didn't become a chief bartender without knowing people.
That's
true. He's almost like a psychiatrist. You know?
But he's also just smart, street smart. He knows what's going on. He's paying attention. And like you said, like they have like a family quality to them. Because right after that, when he points it out, then Doc and Gopher let their libidos take a break. And then they all join together to defend Julie.
And then they turn
Julie.
To, like, falsifying Captain Stewing's job.
Yeah, they turn to fraud.
Totally.
So do your Meryl Stewing. Do yours. It's so, okay, I'm not going to embarrass you. I don't want to put you on the spot, but his is so good. It's you guys would be blown
equally
good.
But that's kind of equally as bad, yeah, that they tricked her. No matter how horrible she's being, that they tricked her.
I'd like you to do something for me, Miss Evans. I'm going to have a very important guest at the party tonight, a Mr. Humbertson. I'd like you to give him some special attention, if you know what I mean.
What kind of special attention did you have in mind?
Really? And then, it's a classic. Another classic storyline, but then they tell her to wear the red dress that got her in trouble from Captain Steubing earlier because it was too revealing.
Yeah, and okay, so there was one shot, maybe this is getting too granular, but there's one shot at that point where she's wearing the red dress that looks like the Sasquatch film. Did you notice this?
Wait, is she walking past or something?
Yeah, she's walking past.
Yes, yes.
But it gets all blurry for a second.
I remember
that.
Really,
I do
weird.
Remember it now that she's
it looked like
it
the Sasquatch film.
Dude, back when we were kids, Sasquatch, strange. Loch Ness Monster were very popular. They were everywhere. Yeah. So I think maybe they were capitalizing on that.
Oh,
you
maybe
know?
It was a reference to Sasquatch where she's
or
walking.
$6 million.
Because In Search Of was on back then. So that episode probably came on very powerful.
And, yeah.
They utilized that really well.
Yeah, and I wrote down Doc and Gopher ruin Connie's career. They make it so she gets not only fired, but I don't think she's going to be allowed on a ship anytime soon.
That was a killer scene, though. And this is where I thought of Michelle, because Michelle admires and likes Gavin McLeod so much and Meryl Steubing, that you see Meryl Steubing really, really like take this seriously, and he lays down the law.
But this was Julie's fault, all of it.
Then consider yourself lucky, Miss Evans. After you leave the ship tomorrow, you won't have to work with her anymore.
I'm fired?
Exactly. Yes, come in.
Captain, there's something I think you should know. Connie was sandbagged.
I beg your pardon?
Someone on the crew imitated your voice, sir, and set Connie up so that she'd embarrass herself tonight at your party. They did it to protect me. They knew she was after my job.
Your job?
Yes, sir.
Well, this girl isn't qualified to do half your job. Sandbagged or not, you should have had more common sense than to throw yourself at a passenger. Good night, Miss Evans. Goodbye.
But after that, Julie still shows what a good person she is.
Yes.
She still hasn't turned completely on this person, and she says that she could be a good cruise director. She has the potential.
I don't see the potential.
I really don't either. Because what did she do to prove herself?
Nothing.
Nothing. She
Wait,
just lied.
Am I wrong?
Stole Julie's
is it just
ideas.
Is Julie just like too naive?
Yeah,
it's not that she's a good person. She should have crushed her. She should have crushed her when she had the opportunity.
She should have. She should have gone in for the killing blow.
Maybe you're right.
Right
she
at that.
Gone
that
more person? Fantasy Island and gone a little darker.
Yeah.
And like really just.
And you just hear a splash off the side of the boat.
Just say that. Overboard, middle of the night.
Yep. But she gives her, I think, the most important lesson of this episode, which is stop scheming and start working.
Oh, God.
That's what
Julie says.
Do you
know how many times I've heard that from him to me? That's all I've heard the entire time I've known him. Let's push Steven P. Slivka to the brink of Sandy Duncan madness. Ugh. And make him and us finally get to the bottom of this storyline between her being just in the pit of depression because of the loss of their child, deciding they're just going to adopt a child that they met on a boat. And then the fact that the parents show up later on. Why didn't the parents show up in the one thing?
They missed their flight.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. You think you'd be able to get that together when your kid has just taken off on a boat.
Okay, so the parents show up.
Yeah.
The dad gives a speech. The mom didn't talk at all.
No,
did she not have
word.
A SAG card?
No, I don't think so.
Is that why she didn't get to talk?
I don't think she
because
was union.
If your kid is missing,
yeah,
and you're the mom, why would you not
all
say
of
a
the
word?
All of the adults are so tolerant of this kid's behavior. It is insane. They all let him, like, again, wander the boat by himself. Then he's jumping into bed with strange people.
Yeah.
The parents show up, don't yell at him at all. And they just, the kid's like,
oh, imagine,
we're going to take
I
you home.
If I did that, my dad.
Oh, you'd be dead.
Yeah, your kid runs away. First of all, spends money on a boat trip. So he didn't stow away for free. He paid for a boat trip.
He really did. Wow, what an industrious child.
Yeah,
which, a newspaper route.
Which is a needless plot point, by the way. He could have just stowed away.
He said he had a paper route since he was 6 years old.
Yeah, I was confounded. No, there was discussion at my house about that. 6 years old. So he was in
four in the morning.
Yeah, first grade. At 4 a.m, he's
lugging papers.
Hucking papers at houses. So his
the
parents
70s.
Chase him all the way, where, to Puerto Vallarta?
First.
And their reaction is, they're pretty cool about it.
They picked him up in Mazatlan because they missed their flight.
They go to Mazatlan and their response is like, okay.
But the kid goes, like, they're like, okay, we're sorry, we're going to go home. And the kid goes like this.
He goes, no.
Like, no.
I got a new family.
Because they weren't arguing.
Yeah.
They didn't make enough.
These
like
people
a
don't argue.
A persuasive enough argument for him to come home.
You
no.
haven't convinced me.
It was bonkers, dude. The whole thing was bonkers. Yeah.
But then the waterworks turn on and there's so much acting to flutes. I can't even believe it. So the flutes start dialing up. You know it's going to be a really poignant part. And then Sandy Duncan, first of all, grabs this kid with both arms. I don't know if you noticed that.
Yes.
That's weird. And he's crying. She's crying. The mom off camera, not crying. I don't think she's affected by anything.
No.
Yeah.
That's so weird.
But he was adopted too, right? That's the thing.
No.
Like, no.
That's what Sandy Duncan said. Did
no,
he lie?
No, he lied to her.
Oh my gosh. That is crazy, man. That is so... You know what? It's making me yearn for Jim Nabors right now.
Yeah. See?
You know
See?
What?
Now, that Jim Nabors story, easy. Easy get. This one... real tough.
Yeah, talking about his meals and stuff like that. This one is so complicated.
Didn't he lie
and
say his uncle was going to pick him up?
Yeah.
And his,
His uncle who lived in Mexico.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's
going to pick him up. Double lie. So this kid's a lying liar.
That's what I'm saying.
Runaway on a liar.
And he's just getting away with it left and right. And it's just like no one is punishing this kid. No one is telling this kid what's up. He's making all the decisions. It is
completely insane. And so eventually he acquiesces and goes, I think, with his parents. And then all of a sudden, Sandy Duncan's cured. It ends and she's better.
Did she say she was pregnant at the end?
No.
No.
You know what it was?
I couldn't understand
that
last part.
That's what I thought at first. They were now going to consider adoption.
No, there's the adoption.
Yeah, they're going to adopt. They're going to adopt. And Jim Stafford, just to like wing a zinger in at the end, says something totally insane.
Well, that's it made me think like she was pregnant, but then that makes more sense to me.
What did he say?
He said, I never did want to adopt, but you know how women are. That's what he said.
Us women.
That was what he said. Like, I guess I have to adopt a child now.
Oh, gotta make the wife happy. Yeah. Gotta adopt the child.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God.
That is absolutely insane.
Yep.
I love this episode. I thought it was awesome. I loved the insanity of the kid jumping in the bed and all that stuff. It just, I liked all of it. You know, it was very emotional. And yes, there are some weird ways for them to get to what they're getting at. And I think they made some super mistakes. But there are some things that you find in this that are pretty heavy and I think really, really worthwhile. But it's just like bonkers. Insane to get there.
I don't
like,
know what
the
this
idea
is.
That adoption is something to consider to get from point A to point B as far as all that's concerned is crazy. It's just super, super crazy. But I did think that the lighthearted stuff was pretty fun, and I maintain
the fact that Loni Anderson would be interested in Steve Allen.
I think as I get older, I think that that's completely plausible.
His
and
glasses were so small, by the way. I don't know if you noticed that.
But we didn't wrap that up. They ended up not being able to follow through with the people that they picked up.
Yeah, so Polly Bergen and Steve Allen.
It ends nice.
Yeah,
it
does end nice. They can't go through with their adultery. And no, they're
swinging. I thought theirs was great.
Yeah, and they don't split up, and they get back together. Yeah. And then Dave.
Although that was a little disturbing, like the, we're going to do it in the morning, or we're going to do it in the night.
That's right.
And I'm like, I don't want to think about Steve Allen doing it at all.
You know what? I had that exact thought now that you say that. Like when they went into the room, yeah. I thought
that was
the exact
I just want to say that's ageist and gross.
No, all right? Steve Allen is.
Oh, okay.
No, but their storyline did really end really nicely.
Yeah, they get back
comically
together.
Amicably. It was really good. And they were both happy. And that is the magic of the Love Boat. When you rekindle your relationship, that's the
either
nice
rekindle
thing.
Rekindle your relationship or you get married immediately.
Look how many notes Slivka has for this thing. I'm so impressed.
No, this is more like a journal to help me process the trauma of this.
It really is impressive. I need to take a photo of that.
Look, I have it coordinated by storyline.
It's incredible.
In a linear fashion so I can keep them all straight. I have breaks where there's a scene change.
I just highlight my ones that are I need to talk about.
Guys, we're really working hard for you out there. We love the show. We're doing so much work out. And now hang on. Just grab something randomly from your notes that we haven't covered. I want to hear something that you've got written down that we haven't touched upon.
I need to try a tequila sunrise. That's a note that I have here because those look amazing.
Oh, those are good.
There were two tequila sunrises at the dinner when Loni Anderson and Steve Allen were together. They got tequila sunrises.
Oh, okay. So what was your drink of choice in Hawaii?
Mai Tais.
Yes.
They're pretty fantastic.
Yeah.
It's all you should drink in
There was
Hawaii.
A lot of Mai Tais being had. What were your takeaways from this episode? What did you guys walk away from with?
That I, as a youth, I was very underachieving. And I could have used my paper route money and gone on a cruise.
Okay.
To get away from my parents.
Fair. What'd you learn from this?
I learned love endures and heals all and is the thing that binds us in this life. And these are the poignant lessons I learn from the Love Boat regularly. And I also learned that we better get our buns in gear and stop scheming. Start working to find some clothes that we're seeing on this episode, on these episodes.
Definitely true.
And start rocking these regularly, all the time.
We also need to start making the drinks that.
Yeah, with tequila. I was going to say
good idea. Good idea.
A zombie would have been nice.
Oh, that's a great idea. We need to start doing that for sure.
I think that's a great idea.
Yeah. Now, I also learned that Angela's awesome, and thank Angela for providing us with
Absolutely.
That information. We love it. We love it so much. We are, like I said, in the description of the last thing that I posted, the highlight from when Steven P. Slivka joined us first. We do have open invitations to people, and we are trying to figure all that stuff out. It's the hardest part of putting the show together, scheduling everything, but we do want to have other people on the show and to do stuff like that. Thank you guys so much for listening.
Oh, hey.
Yes.
Because I said I would bring this up because you didn't do it. This is going to drop on Saturday. Istvan's birthday is on Sunday.
Oh.
He was given a gift tonight from Slivka and he never opened it.
Okay. Yeah. I'm going
to
open
it. So now
this.
You get to do it now.
You're a real creep.
I'm scared. All right, hang on.
You might want to step back, Michelle.
Did you do the Peter Falk? Did
what?
You paint a picture of yourself? Is that what this is?
I did.
Oh my gosh. Hang on. Oh.
Holy smokes. See?
Oh, you guys, you're going to have to check out the Instagram because Steven P. Slivka just surprised me for my birthday with something I didn't even realize existed. It is the Love Boat World Cruise Game. Oh my gosh. Did you know about this being in existence at all?
No.
Yeah.
Oh my. What's the premise of the game? Did you figure it out? No.
Yeah, I played it for hours before I brought it over. No, I have no idea. You have to, I think it's some sort of journey game. I don't know whether you find love on the way or not.
Wow, I hope so. Thank you.
Or at least a son to adopt.
Oh my gosh. Look at this. Look at the board. Oh, you guys, I'll post pictures of this. This is insane. This is crazy. I have the rules. Hang on. The Love Boat World Cruise Game challenges you to become the star passenger on the ultimate world cruise. You accomplish this by scoring the most points while participating in cruise and port activities. It's a race to the finish, and it takes good luck and a keen mind to select only those activities most suitable to your star role. Cool, man.
It is.
Cool.
It says right here on the box cover, become the star passenger on an exciting worldwide cruise aboard the Love Boat.
That's incredible, dude. Thank you. What a fun surprise.
What a perfect way to end the show.
Happy Love Boat birthday.
Thank you, man. Definitely. Oh, my gosh. And thank you guys for listening again. Thanks for joining us on this episode. And until next time, as always, I am Istvan.
Michelle.
And I'm Slivka.
Captain Steven, please come to the bridge.
And we're loving the Love Boat.
Hi, guys. It's me, Istvan, host of Loving the Love Boat. And before you go, I wanted to invite you to check out my other show, Istvan's Imaginary Podcast. Yes, it is a kids and family show, but I think it's a show anyone can enjoy. Here, take a peek.
Oh, well, Istvan, in my college days, and listeners, I was very active in musical theater. And I was somewhat celebrated in my portrayal of Adam Pontapi from Seven Brides for Seven Brothers, the role made famous by Mr. Howard Keel. And as a matter of fact, I have been told my voice resembles and even rivals his. Here, take a listen.
Bless your beautiful heart wherever you may be. We didn't meet yet, but I'm willing to bet that you're the guy for me.
See?
Dad, that's so embarrassing. I don't understand. Do you hear his voice? He has like a Jim Neighbors quality where it goes into something completely different. It's kind of shocking.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever heard you sing. That is very unlike your voice. Wow. Colorful characters, award-winning music, and humor and content in a capital G-rated glory that can take on any other podcast out there. So whether it's with your kids, nieces and nephews, grandchildren, or just you and your inner child, Istvan's Imaginary Podcast is available everywhere podcasts are found to make you all smile and sing along. Check it out today.